Okay, let's play some damn spades. I want to go a blind nil. I'm going to run if I got that damn ace, too. Come on, play the damn song.
Okay, party people in the house. You're about to witness something you've never witnessed before.
Time to run.
Yes, it's the original human beatbox. Dougie Fresh.
I ain't taking that shit.
The Grand Wizard. MC. Ricky. D and SB in the place to be. We're going to show you how we do it for 8 Spot Kicking Live.
That person's pissed off about that shit.
But when it comes to me and my friend Doug Fresh here, there is no competition because we are the best here. Finesse and press, which we prove. And y'all will realize that we are the move. So listen close up so you all don't miss. As we go a little something like this. Hit it!
Doug Fresh fucking sucks.
Oh yeah.
Playing that was looking motherfucker.
You know what? Lottie Dottie. Lottie Dottie. Lottie. Lottie. You know what?
What the fuck
you
are you singing? Lottie Dottie. Dottie.
We like the party.
Slut.
We don't cause trouble. We don't bother nobody. We're just some men that's on the mic. And when we rock up on the mic, we rock the mic. For all of y'all, keeping y'all in health. Just to see you smile and enjoy yourself. Cause it's cool when you cause that cozy condition. And that
yeah, I hate those blue cards.
So listen to what we say. Because this type of shit, it happens every day. I woke up around
that part of the game right here fucking pisses me off.
I gave myself a stretcher. I'm on and yawning. Went to the bathroom to wash up. Had some soap on my face and my hand up on a cup. I said, mirror, mirror on the wall. Who is the top choice of the ball? There was a rumble double. 5 minutes it lasted. The mirror said,
"You are, you conceited bastard."
But that's true. That's why we never have no beef. So then I washed off the soap and brushed the gold teeth. You know I love Olay because my skin gets pale. And then I got the files for my fingernails.
What?
And I attend on my behalf. I put the bubbles in
that,
the
that could catch a trick.
Clean.
Oh, no, what did the person do?
I threw on my brand new Gucci underwear. For all the girls I might take home. I got the Johnson's baby powder and the polo cologne. Fresh dress like a million bucks. Threw on the ballet shoes and the fly green socks. Stepped out my house, stopped short. Oh, no. I went back in. I forgot my cargo. And then I dilly.
Dally.
I ran through her.
Salad.
I bumped into my old girl.
Salad.
From the
Dally.
This is a girl plays hard to get. So I said, what's wrong? Cause she looked upset. She said, oh,
why does a double nil have two zeros?
I'm feeling sad and blue. You went away and now my life.
Man, this song
is
sucks.
Rainy days, and I love you so.
That fucking sucks.
No, cause you took your love away from me. Now, what was I to do? Just crying over me and she was feeling blue. I said, don't cry, dry your eye. Here comes your mother with those two little guys. Her mean mother stepped up, said to me,
hi.
Looked Sally in the face and decked her in the
eyes.
Punched her in the belly and stepped on her
feet.
Slammed the child on the hard concrete. The bitch was strong, the kid was gone. Something was wrong, I said, what is going on? I tried to break it up, I said, stop it, leave her. She said, if I can have you, she can. Punched her in the belly and stepped on her
feet.
Slammed the child on the hard concrete. Slammed the child on the hard concrete. The bitch was strong. The kids was gone. Something was wrong. I said, what is going on?
Hey, that fucking pisses me off.
I tried to break it up. I said, stop it, leave her. She said, if I can have you, she can't either. She grabbed me closely by my socks. So
well, you gotta hate me when I did this damn blind now.
She gave chase. She caught her quick. She put her finger in the face of MC Rick. She said, why don't you give me a plane so we can go cruising in my OJ? And if you give me that. Sweet. She put a finger in the face of MC Rick. She said, why don't you give me a plane so we can go cruising in my OJ? And if you give me that okay, I'll give you
and
all
if I got that damn ace, I'm gonna
Ricky,
run.
Ricky, Ricky, can't you see?
Somehow your words just hypnotize me, and I just love your jazzy ways. Oh, let's rig my love and on. She kept on. The bitch been around before my mother's born. I said, cheer up. I gave her a kiss. I said, you can't have me. I'm too young for you, miss. She says, no, you're not. Then she starts crying. I says, I'm 19. She says, stop lying. I says, I
come on, slut monkey, slut my white stuff. I can't be a lover. Man, this song sucks. I don't want the explicit version. Is that his goddamn king? That fucking pisses me off. That whore. Come on, monkey. That fucking pisses me off. Well, if I catch a trick, I'm gonna run like a little bitch.
Damn, baby, all I need is a little bit of this, a little bit of
that. Cool, the Uzi.
I ain't tryna beef, I'm tryna get my drink on. Got my diamonds, my fitted and my mink on. I'ma kick it at the bar till it's time to go. Then I'ma get shorty here and I'ma let her know. All I really need is a little bit. Not a lot, baby girl, just a little bit. We can head to the crib in a little bit. I can show you how I live in a little bit. I wanna unbutton your pants just a little bit. Take them off and pull them down just a little bit. Get the kissing and touching a little bit. Coming out your stereos. Hard to tell though, cause I switched the flow. Eyes a little low, cause I twisted.
Yes, you took that damn ace.
I moved the O's. My neck, my wrist, my ears is froze. Come get your she on me, dog. She must have heard about the dough. Now, Captain, come on, say. I get it crunk in the club, I'm off the chain. Number one on the chart all the time, I ain't. When the kid in the house, I turned it out.
Now watch your fucking shit. Back,
that's without a doubt. Shorty shake that thing.
Ah, she's pissed off.
She backed it up on me, I'm like, oh man. I got close enough to her so I know she could hear. System thumping, party jumping, I said loud and clear. All I really need is a little bit. Not a lot, baby girl, just a little bit. We can head to the crib in a little bit. I can show you how I live.
Oh, he's dark as fucking glass.
Just a little bit. Take them all and pull them down just a little bit. Get the kissing and touching a little bit.
They had a ton of bags.
I ain't playing, I'm trying to pop the night.
Five damn bags.
Come on. I can show you how I live in a little bit. I wanna unbutton your pants just a little bit. Take them all and pull them down just a little bit. Get the kissing and touching.
He's having sex with that slut.
In a little bit. All I really need is a little bit. Not a lot, baby girl, just a little bit. We can head to the crib in a little bit. I can show you how I live in a little bit. I wanna unbutton your pants just a little bit. Take them all and pull them down just a little bit. Get the kissing and touching a little bit. In a little bit.
1, 2, 3.
while. And
man, that fucking pissed me off.
Well, help me welcome Howard Storm. Thanks so much for taking the time.
My pleasure.
And some people okay. were asking me, you're going to have Howard Stern? No better, Howard Storm. So you were a tenured university professor and an atheist when this accident happened and you died.
Yes.
And it changed your life completely. Why don't you tell us what happened that day?
On June 1st, 1985, at 11 o'clock in the morning, on the next to the last day of our three-week tour of Europe, I had a perforation of the small stomach, the duodenum, and it took me right down to the ground. It was the most terrifying, painful experience I'd ever had in my life.
Oh,
I didn't know what was going on.
Names.
My wife called the desk at the hotel. They called an emergency service. A doctor came within a very short time, and he knew exactly what was wrong and made it clear to us that if I didn't have surgery immediately, I would die.
Please be out
of
Spades Club.
So he called an ambulance service. They took me to the big public hospital in Paris, Cochin, and I was taken to the emergency room.
That whore.
The same thing. You have to have surgery now. And he made it pretty clear that an hour would probably be too late.
That whore.
I was then taken rapidly over to the surgical hospital, but unfortunately, because it was a Saturday, there was no surgeon available to do
anything.
I was parked in a room and basically kind of forgotten. So I was...
That really fucking pisses me off. That really fucking
left
pissed
in that
me
room
off.
For hours
this really,
as the
this
time
really,
went by,
this
no,
really
no medication,
pissed,
nobody
this
took
really
my blood
fucking
pressure,
pissed
anything.
Me off.
The situation, I knew I was
this
dying.
This really fucking pisses me
and
off.
And nobody would do anything. I was never given any medication of any type. And at 8:30 that night, a nurse came in and said they were unable to locate a doctor and they were trying to get one the next day. The doctors in the United States
that
told
whore,
me my
that whore,
life
that whore, that whore. Was,
excuse me, 5 hours in this experience. And the pain had been unbearable for hours. I knew I was dying. So I told my wife goodbye, and we made
that
our
whore,
goodbyes.
That whore.
I went unconscious, and I awoke from that unconsciousness, and to my absolute delight and surprise, I felt not only wonderful, but I was more alive than I'd ever been in my entire life. All of my senses were greatly heightened. My vision, my hearing, my taste, my touch, my smell. It was just like, I was more alive than I am right now.
Damn.
Did you realize you had died?
It would never occur to me that I died because I was
really
alive.
I guess it's time for another turnaround.
And could you see your body?
Well, when I saw my body, it was extremely upsetting and I refused to believe that was my body because that body was
damn, I should have gone near that right there.
It's just like, that's nothing. I'm alive. That's not who I am. And I heard people calling me outside the room and they seemed okay and they were saying, Howard, hurry, come, let's go. And so I went over to the doorway of the room in the light of the room and out in the gray kind of unlit hallway was a group of people staying out of the light of the room. And I said, I'm sick, I need surgery. Are you from the doctor? And they said, we know all about you. Hurry, come with us. There's no more time to talk about this. We got to go.
Pour the shit
and
on me.
They seem friendly, everything.
Oh, yeah, I thought it was hospital people coming to take me to my surgery. It seemed okay. And I went with them. Then they took me on a long journey, which ultimately led into complete darkness. And at this point, I realized this is
that whore,
all wrong.
That whore,
this is
that
very,
whore,
very
that
bad.
Whore.
These people are not here for my I said, I'm not going with you any further. And they said, oh, yes, you are. You've got to go further. And so they began to push and pull at me. And I fought back with them as hard as I could, try to get them off me. And
were these people?
They were people. They weren't demonic beings. They weren't monsters. They were people. And they wanted to elicit as much pain in me as possible because they had utterly lacking in any sense of compassion or caring. And in this world of darkness and nothing, all they could do subjugate each other to their sadistic
desires. That whore.
You think this is what Jesus talked about, of that, the outer darkness?
More than anything else,
Jesus said you'll be cast up into the outer darkness where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth, where the worm never dies. I mean, that's how he described the negative experience of people that don't reconcile themselves with God.
Well, and it became, I know, very traumatic, and you told me about it yesterday, and we'll hear more of that next week.
Yeah, it's a lot worse than I have to go into.
The damn atomic bomb there.
Something happened after that.
That pisses me off.
That changed your life completely. I mean, even to the point of leaving a tenured college profession and becoming a pastor, a Christian pastor.
I was totally ripped up. I looked like roadkill. You know, I was just destroyed. And in that utter hopelessness and despair, I remembered being a child, being in Sunday school, singing Jesus Loves Me, and most importantly, remembering believing as a child, as an innocent child. You know, there's a wonderful line in the Bible, so for the little children to come unto me, do not stop them, for such as these that will inherit the kingdom of God. That's what we need to draw on, is that simple trust and love. And when that came to me out of utter desperation, no theology, no understanding, no nothing, just desperation.
Because you've been a devout atheist.
Yeah. You know, it's like, I want that. I want what I had when I was a kid, you know, which I had mocked and denounced and ridiculed my whole adult life and tried to turn my students away from that, to my shame. And I called out, Jesus, please save me. And with that, a tiny light appeared in the darkness, and it got brighter and brighter and came over me. And out of this light came hands and arms, and he reached down and touched me. And when he touched me, all the gore, which I had not seen before, but now saw in his indescribably brilliant brightness, just dissolved away. And physically, I became whole, but much more importantly than that was, as he touched me, I was filled with his love, which is indescribably greater than any love I've ever. I wish I had another word, because the love that we experience in this world is not comparable to his love, which is so overwhelming. And the hands went underneath me, around my back, and he picked me up.
Man, that sucks.
Like a mom, like a dad. And held me hard up against him. And I put my arms around him and held him. And he loved me and made me know that it's okay. And he was like rubbing my back. And it was sort of like, it's all right now. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay.
Oh, I wanted to blind him. If he was behind them, I was blind there too.
We started to leave this place.
Come on, Ben.
Of nothing but torment and pain and agony. And as we're traveling up, I see off in the distance this enormous center of light with all kinds of activity around it, like a mega galaxy of light. And I go, oh, I'm just like a piece of garbage. He's made a terrible mistake. I don't
want. Why did you say that?
Because I was. I mean, Jesus came into, I'm not talking about a trash heap, I'm talking a garbage dump, I'm talking a cesspool of filth.
Way to back up your partner.
And he touched me! Why would he touch me? And he restored me. And he loved me. And he's taking me there, and I thought, he's made a terrible mistake. He should put me back where I belong. And he spoke to me. And he said, we don't make mistakes. You do belong. Like, and I go, and I realized I hadn't said that. I thought that. And I thought that. Do you know what I think? And he said, I know everything you've ever thought.
That poor, that.
And I went, oh no, that's bad. Can I tell him what I thought? And
I, yeah, that poor, that poor, that poor, that poor.
I thought it's about so... a woman without her clothes on. And he thought that was so funny. Jesus thought it was funny, and I thought, he thinks I'm funny! And it was like so great, and I thought, if he knows everything I've ever thought, I've got nothing to hide. It's good. I mean, we're tight. And I just want to say that, you know, people talk about his love all the time, but I want to introduce a different word in here. Really, a really complex, important word. He likes us. He made me, I mean, and I knew, and he explained this to me very deliberately and carefully, that he made me. He doesn't make junk, and he likes me. He does not like the things that I do that are destructive to myself, destructive to the people that I'm in relationship with, or destructive in God's plan and purpose and love for me. He doesn't like those. He doesn't like our sin. But he loves us and likes us. And the reason why he doesn't like the sin is he wants us to be better than that. You know, he just wants us to be wonderful. Yeah. And that's what I've been trying to do. And of course, I've had lots of failures. And I've had a few successes. But the thing that I know, and he made it really clear to me, is the intention, the effort to be good, to be loving, to be kind, to follow him, is what pleases him. Not the success. It's been really hard for me to figure this all out, but I'm going to pass this on. He doesn't expect me to be Billy Graham or, you know, anything. He just wants me to be really good Howard, you know?
Just that's like very free.
Just like my mom wanted me. Just, she didn't want to care what I became, just as long as I was a good one. Household in the 50s and in the 60s, it became very disillusioned with the materialistic mentality where, frankly, money was not. Wealth was everything. You judge people by where they lived, what they had, and what kind of cars they drove, and what kind of clothing they drove. I mean, that was the sole measure of everything. In those days, back in the 50s and 60s, this was considered to be a Christian country. People went to church. We went to Sunday school. Women in those days taught Sunday school. And they had an infectious love for us kids. And I thank God for them, because I wouldn't be alive today if it went for those women who gave up their Sunday mornings.
That whore, that whore, that whore, that whore.
Church. No. When I became an adolescent, now this is the early 60s, the world was changing. There was something in the water, there was something there. Maybe it was the fluoride they put in the water. I wanted to be relevant in my generation. So, married and with a child, we
we moved to San Francisco in 66.
Time to run.